is 7th anniversary of Guruji's, one of the Guruji's disciples, Reverend Yagi, Venerable Yagi. And we are supposed to be commemorating his trip. And I wanted to make a little commemoration marker. But he always taught me that when you do something important, you have to put everything in perspective. If you, everything is, because everything is connected. If you do something, if you want to begin something, then you have to see all connections. And we realize, although this is the picture of Supreme Medicine Man Throat Hubble of the One Planet Nation, who actually invited Fuji Guruji to this place. He went in 1983 in Vienna, Austria. Peace Pagoda was inaugurated. And we asked him to come with us, to ask Guruji to come to this way, because Guruji always respected in that way. And this is the native people's land. Mm. So along with Trotato, and Dennis was at that time in jail, so he had to send his brother, Mark. And Mark and Hank Hazel, who offered the land of the Grafton Festival, all went along and met Guruji at that time and invited to this way. Well, that's why we have this picture here, and since then our Wampanoag people are protected here. anyway, I thought we have in order to begin putting some that kind of marker, we have to honor first the great spirit, the spirit of the ancestors of this land. And we always forget about it. Because we didn't know how to care, how to take care of land so well, like the people, indigenous people here. So it's very important time that we start bringing back, well, they are there, here, but we don't even. So we need something to always remember. So we thought we should dedicate this for this purpose. So we like to invite, we like to beg, we like to ask people of this land who are from the beginning here to offer. This is very abrupt happening, but we like to first invite people of the Wampanoag Nation, if you could call for the ancestors and come be around and remind us your existence.
Standing amidst the rain and the mist and the purification, that we are reminded of our relationship to Mother Earth, with Mother Earth, and to Grandmother Moon, oldest brother, the son, grandfathers, and to, of course, this planet that we call Mother Earth. This is our mother, your mother. She gives us all that we need to live. The air, the water, the food, and the soil. But again, if I was to say, if someone was to ask me, what were the worst 1,000 years in world history, I would have had to say I lived through part of that. From 1492 to 1592 to 1,000 years in between there. We have polluted this land. We have destroyed the water. We've ruined the soil. The seventh generation will look back upon this generation, our generation, and they will say, what in the world did they do? What did they leave us? And I don't want to be listed. And our people across this land don't want to be listed as being part of the destruction of Mother Earth. Mother Earth will hurt and be pain. And then she will say, I will take all my children and I will bury them. And I will start over again. That's where we're at. In June and May of 1969, when I saw the Cayuga River catch on fire. The Cayuga River catching on fire. And I started to weep, saying, what are we doing to Mother Earth? So I ask you to take those thoughts with you today, but knowing that the strength of the Wampanoag, of the people here, that we are still strong. Across this country, we still believe, we still somehow believe that something good is going to happen. Mm-hmm. And now we ask you to lead that charge. We've taken care of this earth for many years. And we ask you to join. We ask you to lead. Lead that charge. Good day today. My history, though, that I want to talk to you about is my history with Nipanzad Nihoji. It goes back to 1956. I was in the military, I was in Japan. And I think some of you have heard the story, and we were called out to
They were having big demonstrations against the Air Force expanding the runway. And I had signed up. My career was going to be a military. I was going to go into the military for 30 years. And I was trained for aerial photography. And that's what I was going to do. I was going to take pictures from the air, which I started to do for a year and a half. And then they called us out early one morning that there was a big demonstration going to go on. They were protesting the expansion of Yokota Air Base, which is a big strategic air command base in Japan. And the big B-52s were coming, the B-36s were coming, and they could land on a 1 mile runway, but to take off fully loaded, they needed 2 miles. And so they were expanding the base, and this part went into Sunagawa. And that's when the farmers, the teachers, students, said no. You've taken enough land, no more land. And so they organized a series of demonstrations against the military, and then against the Japanese government. At first they were protesting around the government, and then they turned their eyes at the expansion site, and they started to have demonstrations. Then they called for one huge demonstration, and that's when they called us out early that morning. They were arrived about 9-10 o'clock that morning. And then they called us about 3, and they said that people are coming, and we're going to have guards. Everybody turns into security today. And so they had every 10 feet, they had a military. And I was one of them with a weapon. And so all around the base, on the inside perimeter, and there was a fence there, and there was Japanese, on the other side of the fence, it was Japanese military, and then Japanese police. Why Yokota was so important is because it had the capabilities of landing nuclear weapons on Japanese soil, of which it did, because I was there. And a lot of times, you know, they're saying they have a top secret mission coming in, and that's what everybody had to be alerted to. And there was special security around those planes that were carrying weapons. So that's why there was a lot of concentration to protect Yokota Air Base. And Sergeant, during the briefing, which was about 4 o'clock in the morning, Sergeant Johnson was sitting next to me, and he says, what are we doing out there? What are we guarding? What are we going to do? He says, well, you're to prevent anybody from coming over that fence. It's a big cyclone fence. And he says, well, what if they come over? What's our position? And he says, you are to stop them. How do we stop them? And shoot them. And this is when it started for me. I had signed on to be in the military. But of course, in the military, you have military targets. And that was my thinking. I mean, the way I think now, I mean, war is absolutely horrendous. You know, there is no peaceful military objective. So he said, you got to shoot them. Well, how do we, do you want us to shoot to cripple? You shoot to kill. And that's when I said I could not do that. And there was a lot of GIs in there too. They were saying, whoa, this is military. This is peacetime. And there's no war going on. There's no beachhead, you know, to take. We got on the buses, we got around the perimeter, the standard message. I was talking to Kobayashi, Japanese guy, who became was my friend for many years, still is, and Kim Toy, Chinese verse. We're standing there with weapons, and I say, Kobe, I said, you know, I'm an American Indian. This is not my land, but I feel strange being in this position. And I didn't sign up for this, but here we were. Then about 9 o'clock, of course, there's nobody out there yet. Then about 9 o'clock in the morning, we could hear this faint sound of drums. And the person was getting louder. And then I said, oh man, what's going on, guys? And we could hear. And there was not hundreds, but tens of thousands of people walking, marching towards the base. And in front were these men and women and yellow robes on. And I had never seen them before in my life. But they're chanting, pounding on this little flat drum. And I didn't know what they were chanting, but I was kind of getting scared. But here they come, and there was huge flags and banners that they were carrying, thousands of them. And they were getting closer and closer. Pretty soon they were right up, like, in our face. And they were about half a mile wide. And they were making this huge, huge calling with what they were chanting. I didn't know the words, and I seen these monks. They knelt down, and they were praying, and they were just facing the military, facing their police and military, cyclone heads, and behind that was the U.S. military. But they stayed there, and hours went by, finally, 1 o'clock in the afternoon, some disturbance began to happen, and the Japanese police rushed the protesters. And the first line was the monks and nuns. And they just start hitting these nuns and monks. And it sounded like coconuts. They were hitting coconuts. And Johnson was about 3 soldiers away from me. He had a BAR and he just started shooting up in the air like that. And he just startled everybody, and they stopped for a few seconds. And Johnson said, "That goddamn thing jammed on me." And I said, "That's what I saw." And Kobayashi said, "That's what I saw too." And air police is coming running, they got their sirens going, barreling on over where we're at, and he said, what happened? And Johnson said, "I don't know, but I'm just holding it." So all of a sudden it clicked and started firing rounds. It was an automatic. And they asked us if we saw that, and I said, "That's what I saw." But it halted for a moment. What I thought was the worst brutal scene that I had seen in my life. And one of the men were killed. Never made it. He put him in an ambulance, but he died. And those people, those monks and nuns, were the pawns on Minahoji. 20 years went by, and I was sitting at Itami. I wrote a letter to Nipponza Myohoji, not knowing that this was the same group that was Sunagawa. And I asked them if they would help us on this walk that we were planning, called called the longest walk and they came to visit me. Now that I was the chancellor at DQ University and Guruji came and some of the monks and nuns who are sitting around here today, we were talking about this downstairs, how far our connection to each other goes. And Guruji was there, he went into the sweat lodge with me, and there was just four of us in the sweat lodge. And he said he enjoyed the heat, and after that, he said they were going to join the longest walk. And they were somewhere close to on the east by now. And they did join. And they walked the rest of the way to Washington, D.C. And made a tremendous appearance in Washington with some of the biggest names in Hollywood, Marlon Brando, Tony Bennett, and Stevie Wonder, and the greatest boxer of all time, Muhammad Ali. Big people. And there was Guruji. And then they were chanting. And I remember that chant of so many years ago. And that's what that action at Sunagala convinced me that I no longer wanted to be part of the U.S. military. This is not what I envisioned in my life. And this is not what I wanted. I did not want to be part of the destruction of another human being, even though I signed up in the military. Well, many of our young people do sign up for the military. And we have envisions of being, you know, a strong part of our defense. But we've never defended this land, ever. We always go to some other war, some other country, go over there. And we have to fight the people who are defending their land. That's what goes on. That's what I don't understand about this military, our military. Your military, a military, it's wrong, wrongful action. But my acquaintance and my with the Panzan Myoji began in 1956, when I first heard that those chants. Since then, I've been with them to Sri Lanka, I went to Japan with them, and went to Sri Lanka, to India, Rajgir, climbed the mountain at Sripada in Sri Lanka, and walked with them in Europe, and they've had nuns and monks go with us, and most of our walks across the country and in Europe, and in Southeast Asia, and in the Far West. So, Far East, rather. I've walked many miles with them. I've not walked as many miles as they have. I probably will never reach that either. But I've been to many places where they make dedications to do stupas, and make beautiful reminders that peace is the only answer. It's the only direction that you should follow and make with your life. The absence of war really does not mean peace. The absence of poverty doesn't mean people are through fighting. We have to commit ourselves to a whole different way of understanding what life is about. We have to understand, and once we commit ourselves, then it's very hard. It's a very hard and long walk And you can walk them for the rest of your life. But we have to never abandon the thought that there can be peace. We can say that we were part of the beginning. We were part of it. When they look back, they'll say, when did this word peace come about? And I want to be on that list. I don't want to be on the list that says that I was part of the destruction of Mother Earth. Because Mother Earth has a long memory. It remembers forever. That's a long time. It will remember who set the fire on the Cayuga River. It will remember who dropped the bombs at Hiroshima and Nagasaki. It will remember who massacred people at Wounded Knee. It will remember all of the wrongs. The good things Mother Earth doesn't need to remember. Doesn't need to remember. Right now it's being outweighed by the bad deeds that are being committed against Mother Earth. So, your quest for peace is going to be a long, tough journey. And people are going to laugh at you. They're going to snub you. You won't be invited to their parties. You won't be invited to their homes at all. But the ones that you do meet along the way are the people that you want on your side. Those are the ones that will cover your back. Those are the ones that will come to your aid when you need it. When you don't have any money to buy food, start walking. Get that drum off and start walking. The food will come to you. You let your prayers be answered in that fashion. So, to be a monk or a nun is probably the hardest occupation in this world. The hardest. Because, let me see, what kind of salary do these nuns and monks get? What do they do? What do they have to do? They get beaten by law enforcement. They get beaten by people who don't understand what they're doing. When they start pounding those drums at 5 o'clock in the morning, people down the road are saying, "What the hell's going on again?" And they'll have little petitions against them. So if you walk for peace, remember that it's not hardly a peaceful journey, but it's a memorable journey. And you'll remember the friends forever that you make. And they will remember you. And I'd rather be a friend to a monk and a nun than to some Republican figure. Or a Democratic figure. Or in, I want you to stay away. There are three things as a monk or a nun that I want you to stay away from. I consider you all monks and nuns. I want you to stay away from three things. Wood ticks, lunatics, and politics.
This is a lady rock singer from our tribe in Mashpee, and this is not a whole group, but they represent the Eagle Clan, the Eel Clan, and we have the Two Bear Clans.
Yeah.
Actually, I tried to prepare many papers and words and sentences to say in this day, but I lost everything with this journey. It's a mind, it's a time travel for me to go through all the stages or the parts of today. Now, I'm so thankful. It's an amazing experience for me to be in this wonderful place with these wonderful people. People who are giants in their achievements, maybe not in size, but their achievement or their world. And in this place itself, which is wonderful. So I thank you all for having me here. It's my pleasure and my honor. Now, I will try my best to gather my thoughts and touch two points. First point is Islam. Unfortunately, people who are shown as Muslims are not. And the Western, if we can call them the Western people, people who live in the West, are not getting the right impression, the right idea about Islam. Islam in language means salam and shalom, so it's peace. Our greeting is Assalamu Alaikum, which is peace upon you. Now, such a religion cannot kill or shouldn't kill. But unfortunately, some people misinterpret the principles or the fundamentals of Islam, and they use this to kill innocents. Now, for you all, in the eyes of Islam, if you believe in one God, one Creator, if you respect all the prophets and the religions, if you respect the others, if you don't trespass physical or emotional or honor belonging of the others, if you believe in death and afterlife, you are Muslims. You are all Muslims. Maybe not practicing, but yes, it is true. I mean, that's how a Muslim is. We have our prophet Abraham, as we call him, kind of, if I can translate, the unifying prophet, because he's the father of the religions. Now, we look at the religions as whatever number of religions in the world, and we have quite many actually in Iraq. So religions are branches of that stem. Some fruits ripe early, some fruit don't. Some fruit look red, some are green, some leaves are different, but they all belong to the same stem. So we all have the same principles, the same fundamentals. But unfortunately, we as people, we don't look at our similarities, we look at our differences. We always try to say, oh, he's tall, she's African-American, he's Muslim, she wears the headscarf. And we don't go to our similarities. God in Quran, our God, Allah said in Quran, I am able to create you all the same principles, the same religion, the same culture, just as one family. But I decided to create you different, so you know each other. Now, again, forgive me for my just flying thoughts, but this gives me a hint about America. The thing I like about America, you go on a train, and in the same car, you see 10 nationalities. You see all the colors, all the kinds of people. Now, this is enriching America. Unfortunately, recently, in the last two decades, this is not. It's just like having money. Sometimes it's a blessing, and sometimes it's a curse. If we use it the right way, if we look at it the right way, it's a blessing. Again, forgive me, but I want to touch two points. One is Islam and women, and the other one is the things I learned in my journey or my trip to Turkey and Jordan, meeting the Syrian people. Now, Islam and women, I will mention one incident that happened to me. Now, my wife wears the headscarf, so, excuse me, me as a male,
with dark features, people will think, oh, maybe he's from that country or from that country. But when people see a woman with a headscarf, they don't think which country she's from. They just say she's a Muslim. So it's one probability, no else. They don't think any other possibilities. Now, our Prophet Muhammad said, take care of women, and he didn't say women, he said, if I can translate this right, crystals or flasks. You know these thin glass ornaments? Women are very fragile and very sensitive. So the incident I would like to mention is 2010 Children's Hospital, Boston. My son was going to the cath lab. He's having a catheterization, and it's a long time. We are waiting at the waiting area. My wife went in to check on Ali, or maybe he was done and she can visit with him. I was in the waiting area, and there was a big screen, a TV in the waiting area, a couple of families. The family I was talking to came from another state. They weren't from Massachusetts. And unfortunately, the subject on the screen was about the Major Nidal Hassan. You all know about Nidal Hassan, who shot people at the Fort Hood. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm not defending Nidal Hassan. I don't defend anyone who killed. Anyone who kills it's enough for him to be bad to be in that position. He defines or she defines herself to kill others. Anyhow, but this was the subject on the TV, and this family was talking about it, and we got conversation together, myself and the family. And of course, I didn't defend him. I said, he's crazy, he doesn't represent anyone. The conversation was going for maybe 5 or 10 minutes. Now, I didn't intend and I didn't want to announce that I'm Muslim, because this will take us into another turn, and they would have their own stereotyping in their files and their brains about Islam and people. But it was a nice conversation, and it's a nice engagement, until my wife steps into the waiting area. It's quite an amazing experience for me. So my wife steps into the waiting area. She didn't come to me yet, but everything went into silence. Just that we lost the conversation, we lost the connection somewhere. And then, for their amazement, for their shock, she came and sat next to me. Well, I could feel that they thought, kind of, I'm betraying them. So they, for a while, they thought I'm on their side, but now, obviously, I'm on the other side. So, I didn't talk to that family until maybe 2 hours later. The father came to me and started mentioning something. So he was kind of making up. I think he realized that he made, or they made, the judgment at the wrong time without any evidences. Now, for me, that's okay. For any male, it's okay. But for women, these things are tough. Now, what can we do about this? Our imam, one of our imams said, don't ask about the road, ask about the fellow. And don't ask about the home or the house, ask about the neighbor. So actually, whatever the trip, whatever the road we are making, if we are accompanying the right people, it will be fun, it will be nice. They will help us when we limp, when we fall, when we get injured. The point is, sometimes, or actually most of the times, we can't change. Now, I have a 7-year-old son who I can't change his ideas. I just can't. So I try my best, and I don't look at the result. The results are not my business. It's God's business. My business is to work, to will, and struggle, work for achieving that result. Then if I get it or not, this is not my job. What I want to say is, you are very blessed people to be all together. And we work together, we might not achieve, but we will stay together. And that itself is an achievement. This is one. Two is, if we don't succeed in changing the others, which is the most probable, if we have enough faith in our hearts, we can make that change. Now, this might look very odd, but maybe the Syrian bombing didn't happen because some people had strong faith and they prayed for their God, whoever their God is, and a true spirit from their souls, from the deepest part of their souls, they prayed to prevent that war and it didn't happen. I don't know, it might happen again. I mean, next, but might not. The other thing is, so that's the same with destroying these walls between religions. Oh, she's a Muslim, oh, he's a Muslim. If we in ourselves have that faith, this will be reflected on the others. In Islam, we have a very special prayer. It's called kind of after midnight prayer. So it's a special prayer because God, Allah, is awake while the people are sleeping. And it's enlightened the people. You can request and ask God anything. But for this special prayer, if you want to ask anything for yourself, you have to ask and pray for 40 people. You have to mention 40 names, asking for forgiveness, health, everything good, and then you mention your request. So if we apply this in our real life, which is a prayer actually, then we can achieve something through our faith and our prayers. The other thing is, I like crisis. I lived all my life through crisis. Crisis is good because it brings people together. Now we came inside so cozy and so close to each other because it was raining. Myself and many people I know came together because it was raining bombs. And actually no shelter can protect you from bombs. But still, it brings us together. So we come together in a crisis. And then we think, we work, we believe in something, and then we spread out. Then, if we have the faith, we have the equipment, we'll spread this power to the others, physically or just by prayers. Now, forgive me for maybe taking time, but this is the first point. The second point is about Syrians. I went for 1 week to Jordan and 1 week to Turkey. We couldn't get into the refugee camps, but the mission was to train the Syrian refugees and medics, Syrian doctors and medics. It's a group of very expert people, doctors from Massachusetts. And I can feel what the Syrians are feeling. Anticipation. It's the most torturing experience to wait. Because I remember these days when the airplane comes, you hear the buzzing sound, and you wait. You just wait a few seconds or a few minutes. Where is this bomb going to land? It might be your home, your neighbors, the other street. Anyhow, so Syrians are anticipating. This is one part. The other part is they are living a very difficult life. Like you can't imagine the lack of water and all the resources, everything. But because I'm an Arabic speaker and they knew I'm Iraqi, a group of them came to me and asked, so do Americans really care about us? Because we feel they just want to get the chemical weapons out of Syria and that's it. So I allowed myself to speak of the American people. But I said, look, the people I know, the people I meet, the people I work with, they walk, they talk, they pray, they donate money, they raise money, they make meetings to help the Syrian people. And I think they believed me. I said, look, don't watch TV, don't believe anything on TV. I live with the American people. Now, I came from Iraq with a different way, way different impression about America and the Americans. Everyone lives in America. I'm not mentioning just the Americans, but the people. For me, it's a strange new land and new people. So when I came to the House of Peace, literally, and I told Carrie for the first few weeks, I was suspicious. Until the signal or the message got into my heart, this is true. Now Carrie and John are my spiritual parents. They're my parents. My son or my kids, who are, I think kids are the best example. My kids call Carrie and John Bibi and Jiddu, which is grandma and grandpa. They know nothing about Islam and Christianity, and they don't care. So, again, that's why I like crises. Because whenever it trucks, whenever it gets too tight, there comes the relief. And you meet amazing people. And if you, just like Mr. Banks said, it's a good day to die. If you die at any of these days during the journey, you are in that team, whether they won or not. But it's enough to be on that team. Now for the other teams, we have to pray for them. So God will enlighten their hearts and their ways until we all come together. I thank you very much. May God bless you. And I send everyone a prayer. Allow me to say it in Arabic, please. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين اللهم اهدنا واهدهم جميعا إلى صراطك المستقيم يا ربي إلى الحق اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد آمين. Thank you very much.
I am happy the Vermont Yankee is shutting down, but not soon enough. It's a very dangerous old reactor. They won't spend any money to fix anything there. And it is putting too many lives at risk. And they've got to stop generating nuclear waste. There is no solution for the nuclear waste. And the chief problem of the reactor are the thousands of spent fuel rods, 70 feet above ground, up on the banks of the Connecticut River, being constantly cooled from water from the Connecticut River. So that hot water is going back into the river. In fact, if you notice, the Connecticut River has not been freezing over the last few years. The Oxbow freezes over, but the Connecticut doesn't. The water is too hot, and it's poisoning the fish. And these spent fuel rods are constantly in need of water to cool them. And if a storm knocks these fuel rods over, we have a Fukushima on the Atlantic coast of the United States. Spent fuel rods are the most lethal thing the United States, or man, our species, has ever developed. Human standing within a few feet of a spent fuel rod that isn't in the water would die within a few moments. The zircon alloy cladding the spent fuel rods has to be in hot and water constantly. And if it isn't, then it explodes. And all of that, the elements, the radiation, will kill people. And the only solution is to get those fuel rods, those thousands of fuel rods, out and in a containment vessel where they can't get air, and they should be buried deep underground and not shipped off to Texas for some poor community to take them. But, you know, we who have used the power of electricity have got to take responsibility. And Connecticut cannot need to do it. So we say shut it down right now.
The decision to shut down Vermont Yankee is, in fact, a tremendous people's victory. Everything Francis says is absolutely true about the continuing problem in the next 14 months. But I think we should not lose sight of the fact that the thousands and thousands of people in Vermont, Western Massachusetts, Southeastern, Southwestern, New Hampshire, and elsewhere, who have opposed this plant in so many ways, many, many different ways for so many years, have achieved a victory. And the company may make it sound as though, and they have, they're only shutting down for their own internal economic reasons. But the fact is, what has happened here in Vermont and in this area, and with the help of our elected officials, especially those of Vermont, has been very much part of the story of why they're closing down. They are operating what they know is a very hostile environment because of all their crimes and their cover-ups and their lies. So we should celebrate that. It's also a validation for citizen action in general. All of us, can make a difference. There are problems still remaining, not only with the waste that Francis talked about, but of course there are 103 other nuclear reactors in the United States. 22 others of the exact same design as the ones still melting down in Fukushima. And all over the world there are more. So I just wanted to end with, maybe you've heard the former director, is that what he's called, of the Nuclear Regulatory Commission. Commissioner, thank you. Gregory Jasko, after stepping down and essentially being fired, said that all 104 nuclear power plants in the U.S., quote, have a safety problem that cannot be fixed. This is the former commissioner, the Nuclear Regulatory Commission. And he went on to say, continuing to put Band-Aid on Band-Aid is not going to fix the problem. And finally, I just want to quote the former Prime Minister of Japan, Prime Minister Nun, who said, who was Prime Minister at the time of the Fukushima original meltdown, the beginning, said, and who was a strong supporter, let me say, of nuclear power. He said, I concluded after the catastrophe began that the only way to contain the risk, this risk, is to create a society that does not rely on nuclear power. And he went on to add, we have created a situation where we are standing on a precipice. Will we be able to survive, he asked.
This brings about the demonstration. My father and uncle delivered the food to the Fuji Guruji at that time, not to Dennis Banks, unfortunately. My English comes out sometimes wrong, so I'll have to say in Japanese, and she's gonna translate you.
His English is
good enough. Yeah. この戦争を食い止める力はアメリカの人々が皆核兵器の人類全滅の災いをとどめるため立ち上がることであります。立ち上がってどうすることでもない歩くことであります。立ち上がって集会を開くことであります。立ち上がって南無法蓮華経を唱えることであります。この一つは誰でもできます。子供でもできます。 年寄りでもできます。この一つで核兵器の災いを食い止めることができると結上していくところに信心、信仰が必要であります。信ぜねばできないことであります。これを疑えば他に何か核兵器の災いを食い止める道があるか、それがないんです。ここでいかにしていいかわからなくなりました。ここに日本の仏法、南無法蓮華経は核兵器の災いで人類全滅の時、核兵器の火を止めるために残されたお釈迦様の唯一の教えであります。
The power to stop the war, the power to stop this war will come from the people of the United States as they stand up against the threat of nuclear weapons. Simply stand up and walk, stand up and have gatherings, stand up and chant Nam Myo Ho Renge Kyo. Anybody can do that. Even small children can do that. Even old people can do that. But we need to have a faith to do it. We must believe that we can do it. If we have a doubt, is there any other way to achieve our goal? No. A Buddhist Dharma, Nam Myo Ho Renge Kyo, is the only teaching that the Lord Buddha gave us to stop and stop the fire of nuclear weapons. That's the word of the Fuji Guruji.
Every time I visit here for Grafton Peace Pagoda, I feel confident that this wish will come true.
Yeah, I just want to say that the New England Peace Pagoda, we are, have to say, committing ourselves until this bill is achieved and until these uranium mines are closed and cleaned up. We have to commit to everything, not just this, but this we feel is such a deep thing, and it is the beginning of the whole nuclear chain. So as you have often said, Vanessa, if we have to stop it all, but if we do stop the beginning, sort of spiritually or something, we are somehow stopping the whole thing, or at least we're getting the people's hearts and minds clear. We've got, you know, it's just all finished. And also, so important that it's a, we feel that this bill that the Defenders of the Black Hills has written and is starting to move out, that this is, the divine hand is moving this, because it is a way to stop the nuclear chain, and it is a way to change our relationship with the First Nations people to one of respect, to understanding that this is the absolute responsibility to stop and clean this up. How can we not do it? And so it's powerful transformation in a lot of ways. Thank you very much.